Now, as far as the abnormalities of shape, let us first recall what is a normal placenta. It looks like a disc, like a flattened egg, which is weighs about a pound. It is about 2.5 centimeter thick. So this is a normal shape of placenta. There are number of variants to this. So a placenta can look like this. You can see two different part, one single cord, but before divides into two main vessels and supply two parts. ठीक है, this is called biparietal placenta. ठीक है, the placenta is divided into two equal lobes. Another possibility is to have a lobe placenta. It is not divided into, in this case, the placenta is not divided into separate lobe. It is still one in one thing, but it has a lobed appearance, not like a even margin all around, just like a lobed appearance. Okay? This is called lobe placenta. Very rarely it is possible to have a diffuse placenta. No, not even biparietal, not even lobe. The placental tissues are divided into in equal component. This is called diffuse placenta. Another scenario is to have a placenta succurata. What will happen? There is a low placenta or a normal placenta, but there is a extra cotyledon, which will be like a small lobe. ठीक है, ये this is succurata, placenta succurata. Another possibility to be have a fenestrated placenta. You know what happens in a it is a decidual plate and the chorionic plate which forms the placenta. So what will happen? Chorionic levi which is going to pulses and chorion furandosum which is going to die. So at times there is faulty resolve. Beside chorionic furandosum, there is faulty resorption of the chorionic plate at places in the chorionic plate. This is it, so it will be like a appear like a fenestrated placenta. ठीक है, now the last thing is circumvallate placenta. What is a circumvallate placenta? What we can appreciate in this scenario, the in the center, this is the decidual plate and this is the chorionic plate, which is appears as a shining white ring, which is surrounding the chorionic plate like a ring. So, what is the clinical scenario if there is faulty shape of placenta? So there are some types of variations in the shape which is not clinically significant, which does not give rise to which have a benign cause and does not give rise to dire clinical consequences. But in cases of a placenta succurata or circumvallate placenta, what will happen? There is a chance for a woman to have postpartum hemorrhage, and as we all know that after the birth of the fetus, the placenta is delivered. So if it is a accessory lobe like placenta succurata, it is possible that the whole of the placenta is delivered and this accessory lobe fails to deliver. It will lead to this condition is called retained placenta, in which after the birth of the placenta, the main placental mass is delivered, but the accessory lobe fails to deliver. How it will endanger the life of mother? The mother will continue to bleed, unless it is managed on urgent basis, and this condition is called postpartum hemorrhage. So, what are the clinical presentations? What is the clinical presentation? If there is faulty shape of the placenta, it is possible to have the patient in these two scenarios, postpartum hemorrhage and retained placenta. Now, attachment or abnormalities of the attachment of the cord. What is the normal scenario? It is described in the picture A. What is the normal size? Normally, where do the cord is attached on the placenta? In the my first slide regarding describing the anatomy, gross morphology of the placenta, I describe that it is on the fetal surface, which is shiny surface. The cord is attached in the center, which is shown in the picture. That in the center, the cord is attached. This is the normal scenario. So there are variants to this. It is possible to have an abnormal site of attachment of cord, like marginal or battledore placenta, in which in spite of getting inserted into the center of the placenta, the cord is attached at any of the margin of the placenta. This is called marginal or battledore placenta. Okay. Another possibility that before having final attachment onto the fetal surface of the placenta, the cord divides into is bifurcated, or it divides into number of branches, and it is these are the branches. It's not the main cord. The branches which are inserted or attached, finally attached to the fetal surface of the placenta. The fourth variant is velamentous insertion of the cord. The velamentous insertion of the cord is one of a consequence of a battledore placenta, in which a step forward, like in this case, in case of a velamentous insertion of the cord, the umbilical cord is attached at the margin of the placenta, and it is not really the placenta where it is attached. It is first inserted into the membrane. The main cord, the main fetal vessel, are first insert, or the cord it is inserted into the membrane. It is attached to the membrane, and after traversing a little short course on the membrane, it finally supplies the placenta itself. So this scenario, if we talk about clinical consequences, if unluckily it's a velamentous insertion of the cord, it will adversely affect the placenta. How? Because we all know during labor, I have already described it, it is inserted into the membrane, the cord is inserted into the membranes which is covering the fetus. So in early part of the labor, we know before when labor start, the membrane is ruptured first. And if unluckily the portion of the membrane where the umbilical cord is attached, it is this part of the membrane is ruptured in early course of labor, what will happen? Because all the main fetal vessels are supplying the umbilical cord, fetus will be rapidly losing blood. This is called exsanguination of the fetus. And this is a condition, if unluckily this happens, fetal body will be devoid or depleted of blood, will be rapidly exsanguinated, and it is very difficult to save the fetus in this condition. Luckily diagnosed timely and timely managed within it is a matter of minutes, not even hours. If if this condition is diagnosed and managed, then it is possible to save the life of the fetus. Now, abnormalities of the length of cord. It is not the normal length of the cord is about 30, mean length is about 37 centimeter. It is possible to have variants to this normal length of the cord. There are two possibilities, either to have a long cord, which is too long, or it is possible to have a short cord. These are the not considered. If it's a normal, going to be a normal long cord or short cord, it will be regarded in the context of abnormalities of the length of cord, and definitely it will harm the, this condition will harm the pregnancy. For example, if it's going to be a long cord, what will happen, you know, in the utero, how the fetus is surviving this in early part of pregnancy, before term, there's lot of fluid, fetus is moving here and there. So if it is a long cord, it is possible that this cord will be tangled in any of the fetal parts, like arm, like fetal leg, like fetal neck. Fetus is moving here and there, and the cord will be encircled or entangled around the fetal body. So what will happen in this scenario, if unluckily the cord is tangled or encircled around any of the fetal part, it will lead to death of the fetus in utero. Another thing, complications is liver. What will happen? If it's a long clot, what the complication in labor is faced? If it is unluckily entangled around the fetal body, it will not only lead to the death of the fetus in utero. If the patient starts with normal labor, there is failure to progress in labor because during labor, the fetal body has to descend to the birth canal. If there are tangled loop of cord around the fetal body, how the fetus will descend to the birth canal? So it will lead to complicated labor, poor progress in labor, and ultimately patient will be into the scenario in which emergency operative delivery is required. So, another variant, short cord. Again, short cord is again a sign of disease. It is not possible to have a normal pregnancy outcome and a normal fetus in the presence of a short cord. What are the associations of short cord? Either a growth restricted fetus. If the fetus is small, the placenta will also be a small, and the short cord is also small. Okay? Congenital abnormality is due to the short cord. Short cord could be one of the association of congenital malformation. Let me first describe what is congenital malformation. The fetus is abnormal, either structurally or morphologically, not look like a normal fetus. There are some malformations look like an abnormal formation. Then it is possible to be associated with a short cord, and again fetal death in utero. Now, as we know, abnormal penetration of the uterine wall. A normal placenta is in a normal placentation, the tertiary villi will penetrate into the superficial layers of the endometrium. If unluckily it is the placental villi goes deeper and deeper, like first into the endometrium or myometrium or to the serosa, this is called abnormal penetration of the uterine wall, and it will give rise to clinical scenario by either the retained placenta. Because the placenta is deeply invaded villi into the uterine wall, it is very densely, it is very, the bonding to the uterine lining is very tough, and it is possible that in this scenario the placenta fails to deliver after the delivery of the fetus, and the patient will continue to bleed. This is postpartum hemorrhage from the female genital tract after the birth of the child. Abnormalities in the placental volume. There is some correlation between the weight of the fetus and the placenta. What is the weight of a normal placenta? It is about 500 gram or about a pound. So according to our calculation, it is 1/6 the weight of the placenta. So normal placenta, if it's a normal fetus, the placenta will weigh normal. If it's a abnormal fetus, the placenta will also be abnormal. So as a variant to the abnormalities in the placental volume, there are two possibilities: either to have a small placenta or a big placenta. So either if we are having a smaller placenta or big placenta, both of these conditions are again signs of the disease or an abnormal gestation or an abnormal pregnancy. So if it is a small placenta, it is a rule that the fetus will be growth retarded. It's a small fetus, not normal fetus look normal, but it is a small fetus, growth retarded. And at this point, I will especially mention sometimes a small placenta, it is possible to have a small placenta if mother is having any morbidity. The common morbidity is hypertension. If the mother is hypertensive, it is possible that the placenta will be small and the fetus will be growth retarded. Now, another variant is a big placenta. In which scenarios the placenta volume is increased and it's a big placental volume? Birth mentioning is again the medical disorder in presence of medical disorder in the mother, maternal diabetes. Again, another scenario in which the placenta is big is multiple pregnancy. Like there, it's not only one single uterus inside the fetus inside the uterus. There are a number of either two or twins, which is termed as twin, or three, like triplets or quadruplets, and number of possibilities. But if there are more than one fetus is inside the uterus, the placental volume will also be big. And another condition is hydrosfetalis, in which the whole fetus looks edematous, full of fluid. and looks in this situation the placenta will also be big. Fetal hydrops is again present in case of an abnormal fetus. Now, premature separation of the placenta, as I have described, that most of the placental abnormalities they are structural, but there are few placental abnormality which we regarded as functional variant. So it is one of the functional variant, premature separation of the placenta. What is the normal time when the placenta is separated from the endometrium? Yes, during labor, after the delivery of the, when the fetus is born, the placenta will be separated from the uterine line, from the uterine wall, and will be delivered after the delivery of the fetus. So premature separation of the placenta is called, termed as abrupt shoe placenta or placental abrasion. This is the condition which happens if the placenta is separated before labor start and even before the birth of the fetus, while the fetus is still inside the uterus and labor is not yet started. If unluckily the placenta is separated due to certain morbidities, what will it will give rise to? Antepartum hemorrhage, like hemorrhage bleeding from the genital, from the vaginum before the birth of the child, and at times this bleeding is so much so that mother has to be dealt on an emergency basis. Another thing is death of the fetus, because as we already know, the fetus relies on an intact circulation, fetal circulation, placental circulation for its survival in utero. If the placenta or majority part of the placenta is being separated from the uterine lining, it is not possible for a fetus to survive the challenges of in utero life. It will lead to death of the fetus in utero. Now, placental tumors. It is possible that the placenta will take the form of tumors. Okay, what is a tumor? I think most of you must have an understanding what is a tumor. But let me first describe what is a tumor. Tumor is a tissue in which it can arise in any of the body lines, but in which certain cells of certain lineage will undergo excessive mitosis, excessive proliferation, and it will take the form of a big lump. So it is possible that a portion of the placenta, growth of a portion of the placenta will exceed the normal placenta, and it will form a mass or tumor. So in the context of placental tumor, it is possible to have two scenarios. One thing is gestational trophoblastic disease, and another thing is choriangioma of the placenta. Gestational trophoblastic disease, in the which cell line will undergo excessive proliferation, it's the cytotrophoblast and cytotrophoblast. Both of these two type of trophoblast will undergo enormous growth, excessive mitosis, and it will take the form of tumor. So one thing which is worth mentioning is, if it's a gestational trophoblastic disease, it is not possible to have always possible to have a fetus. Fetus may be present or may not be present, but the rule is this: if there is a fetus existing with the fetus will not be fully developed, it will be incompletely developed fetus. What the clinical presentation it will give rise to? Bleeding in first trimester and loss of pregnancy in the first trimester. Now another condition of placental tumor is choriangioma of the placenta, in which the component of that tissue which is forming the blood vessel will undergo excessive proliferation, will take the form of a tumor. And what will be the clinical presentation? Clinical presentation depends on the size of the mass. If it is a smaller mass, it will be unrecognized, it will be a patient will remain asymptomatic till the time when the placenta is born. And we see the placenta, we will be able to appreciate that besides the normal placental mass, there is a tumor which is recognized. But if it's a larger choriangioma, it will be asymptomatic. It will lead to birth of the fetus before maturity achieved, an abnormality in the fetus, again a growth retarded fetus, and abruption of the placenta, that is premature separation of the placenta and antepartum hemorrhage. So up till now I have discussed number of variants of placenta which are regarded as a placental abnormality. This is my last slide. I would conclude my lecture by saying normal placental structure and function is essential for a healthy pregnancy. So what we can see in different type of placental malformation, each and every type is associated with abnormal pregnancy, some consequences on the maternal health and fetal health. Abnormal placental structures, vice versa, abnormal placental structure and function adversely affect the health of the fetus as well as mother. Understanding of the topic that of placental abnormalities and infection can be used to determine the well-being of pregnancy. I would like to thank you all for the patience, listeners, and for any queries, you can contact me on my email address. Allah Hafiz. Thank you.